Hey, it's Fran, again, with kind of a cool vlog. Those of you who follow my Twitter feed would know that I recently was reacquainted with some studio gear that I had loaned to my friend Chris Butler, and I had picked it up a couple weeks ago from his studio in Hoboken. And this is one of the things that I picked up. It's my Otari MX5050 MK3-8 analog recorder. And this is really one of the very last of the fully analog multi-track recorders. A real machine. those of you who have seen some of my analog band recordings that I did in recent years, those were recorded with my Tascam Porta Studio, which is 4-track. This is definitely a step up. It's half-inch tape. Like I said, it runs 15 inches per second or 7.5. That's selectable. And it's a 8-track recorder. And it's kind of a really cool machine. I thought I would take a little time to show you how it works and what it looks like outside and inside. So let's take a closer look. Okay, so here it is close up. It's kind of not really the right aspect ratio because this is pretty square, so with the wide HD, it's going to have to, well, you know, got to do some panning and stuff. But anyway, I'm going to tilt it a little bit so you can see the face here. Okay. The lighting's not too great because I'm using my regular shop lighting, so there's lots of reflection. Okay. Okay. These reels, unless you found a professional recorder, you probably would never have seen anything like this, but the professional tape comes on like a core like this, core reel. There's an adapter. Actually, there's the spindle there for regular tape. So, like, if you're, let me zoom in here. So, for like a regular tape machine, you're used to this little quarter-inch spindle with the little 3 tabs, and that's actually on the reel there, the motor. But this adapter is for these large reels, and it has a little clamp down. You kind of turn the outer piece, and it clamps the holder in place. Then these 3 slots in the reel go into these 3 tabs, like so. And then there's like a ring here that you pull out to secure the tape. Really heavy duty with these big reels. Like I said, this is half-inch tape, it'll, and at 15 inches a second, it goes pretty fast. You use up a reel like this less than 20 minutes, going 15 IPS. So, pull it back here. And this is the head assembly. Okay, this is the head assembly here. 3 different sets of heads. There's an erase head, there's a record head, and a playback head. So when you're actually doing recording, because of when you're doing multitracking, all the tracks have to be in sync. So there's actually 2 different modes of playback. When you're actually doing recording, you're actually listening to the other tracks through the record head, but when you're actually doing playback, without recording, you're using the playback head because they're actually very different. The fidelity is different, and the way that recording heads are made and playback heads are made are very different because you're doing different things with putting the signal on the tape as opposed to actually trying to retrieve the fidelity out of the tape when you're reproducing. So there's I'm gonna turn the power here. Oh, there we go. On the power. There we go. And it's got a counter, a digital counter for get a zoom in here. Okay. Yep. And there's no time code or anything. This is actually just the idler wheel here has an optical pickup. And so if I pull up the, pull up that, I can add time. See, I'm adding seconds. And I can take seconds off and reset. So it's really just kind of a wild time indicator, but fairly accurate. You know, if you're doing song to song, it zeros pretty accurately. So, the idler wheel, it's really just there for to reduce the wow and flutter that you normally would get on the source reel coming through the mechanism. Yeah, that's all that's for. And this tensioner is there's this tensioner here on the source reel, and then there's another one, this one here on the take-up reel, which is a little goozy. See, it's sticking a little bit. Now you really can't oil something like this. It's like this bearing is not meant to be really fast. It's supposed to have like a slow response. It's supposed to act kind of like a weighted, slow weighted arm. So you kind of have to. This hasn't been used in a while, so it's going to need a little TLC. Also, the pinch roller is kind of. The pinch roller, it looks kind of a little whitish because I had to put some. It's polyurethane, and it was starting to get sticky. Polyurethane, when it breaks down, sometimes it gets kind of dry and powdery. Sometimes it gets kind of sticky and gooey, depending on the specific composition as it reacts to ozone and other things. But it was getting a little sticky, so I put some cornstarch on it just to, to get it not stick. that'll probably have to be replaced, although replacement parts for these machines are not too easy to find, so may have to just keep tending that with some cornstarch every now and then. I'll get a close-up of the heads here. All right, so here are the heads. Let's see, this is the erase head. That's the recording head, and that's the playback head. You can see the divisions in the 8 divisions on each head. Also, you can see that they're different. The erase head different than the record and playback heads. And this machine's been moved around quite a lot, so it's probably going to need to be realigned because the heads have adjustment for the azimuth, and so you can align them so that they're actually evenly flush on the tape, and that the specific angle or the azimuth of the head is correct to get reproduction on all of the tracks. And this will probably have to be aligned, I imagine. All right, this is the front panel with individual controls for all the tracks. And there's also two internal oscillators. There's a 1K oscillator and a 10K, and also a line input that is used for aligning the tracks. The two different tones are handy because I'll show you the back that there's adjustments for the inputs and outputs for the recording and the reproduction. And there's also an EQ, a high and low EQ, so the 1K and 10K are handy for the adjusting the EQ on the high and low end. And you can turn each track, that's the safety for recording. So if you definitely want to lock out a track and you don't want to record over it, you put it on safe, and then even if you put it in record mode, it won't record on that track unless you have it on record. And in each track, you can either select all record, or you can do all reproduction, or you can do individual tracks where, when you're doing recording or overdubbing, doing sound on sound or sound with sound, you'll be recording on some tracks and playing back others to hear the playback on the others so that you can record the new track. And that's you know, that allows you to do that. And you can punch in the individual tracks for listening on the phones. So again, you can be selective of the tracks you want to listen to. If you're just using headphones, you don't really need a mixing board to use this machine. It's pretty autonomous. You just need to have a balanced amplifier for your microphone, which I actually don't have right now. I don't have quite the right balanced amplifier to work with this, but that'll be in the works so I can demo this thing a little later. But let's take a look at the top here. Okay, so you got 8 meters and 8 controls, and these controls can either be for the record level or the reproduction level. If you're using, if you're not using an external mixer, you can, you know, adjust either the record level, which I'll put a tone here, on number one. See, and I've put a tone, a 1 kilocycle tone on the first track here. You can see the VU meter. Okay, and I can adjust that level. Let's see. I can do that with track 2. See? Set. Now I've set all these to 0, so track 3. But yeah. But I'll show the back here. So this is the back of the machine, and you can see everything is adjustable, and so aligning this machine and setting it up takes quite a lot of time. Each track has its own adjustment for the reproduction and the recording features. You can set the oscillator levels. It's a standby mode. You adjust the peak level for each track, the VU meter, again, to align them. Each has a input and output high and low levels for mic and line level. You can set the repro level, the low frequency compensation for each of the tracks. There's that repro EQ, and there's also a record EQ for high and low, and that's where the 1K and the 10K tones come in handy. There's also the selective reproduction level for each track, and the regular input level. And on the record side, you know, record level inputs, you know, everything, basically everything for the recording. The oscillator level for each one, and also the recording bias for each individual track so that you can maximize the fidelity for each track with the bias. It's a high bias system. And of course, your individual ins and outs. I have a remote control for this too, which it's upstairs, but I'll insert a picture of it. And it's connected through this 50-pin connector here. The cable is still AWOL. I'm still looking for it. It's packed away somewhere. But I have a 50-foot long cable. It's a big, thick cable that connects the remote with the recorder. So you can have the recorder in a totally different room and have the remote with you. So if you're recording, you don't have to have an engineer. You can control the machine yourself from a distance or in a completely different room, and the remote control has the same readout for the tape position and everything, so you don't actually have to be with the machine to use it, which is one of the really great features of this particular machine, and the remote control is still pretty rare. Let me take the back off. I'll show you the inside. We'll do a little mini tear down. Alrighty, there you go. So you can see inside there's 8 different boards. There's one board for each track, which has the record and reproducing circuits for each track. And then this board is the all the oscillators, and also I believe this is the timing and the control, because it is servo controlled, so the servo controls are. This is really cool. There's this really long custom resistors. There's three of them in here. This custom resistor network. It's very interesting. Not really gonna get into this. You can look up the schematic online. It's pretty involved. Certainly not gonna get into the electronics of it, but the modular nature of it makes it real easy to pull out any one of these channels. They're just there's a big backplane in there. So many trim pots. Yeah, I'm not really looking forward to aligning this. It's going to take quite some time with an oscilloscope to get it all lined up. But lots of trim pots, to be sure. Not fun. So that's pretty much the rundown of the machine. I'll show you how to put the tape on. But if you go on eBay or whatever, looking at these half-inch decks, the first thing you're going to find is that the tape for these machines, if it's new tape, is very, very expensive. But fortunately, when I bought this machine back in 2001-ish, early 2001, Quantigy was still making their GP9 mastering tape, and I actually bought an entire case of half-inch tape. So I'm set for tape for quite a while. But the tape pathway on this machine is very, very simple. Just goes like this, and then like this, and then doing this upside down and backwards. And that's pretty much it. Ta-da! Easy. And so we'll play. Yeah. It's squeaking. The tape is a little squeaky. Like I said, that idler wheel is a little sticky. And the cap spin is probably needs a little cleaning. But yeah, it's going to need some TLC, definitely. Yeah, that's definitely its. Yeah. Idler wheel needs to be cleaned. Anyway. TLC, it needs a little work, but that's pretty much it. When I get this working and get it aligned and get it coiled and cleaned, I'll probably do a nice little demo, a little multi-track demo with it. Don't know when I'm going to have the time to do that. It won't be too soon, but I'm glad to have this back, and certainly an amazing piece of machinery, and like I said, one of the last, and I'm glad to have it. So, well, that'll do it, and I'll see you soon. I'm Fran. Bye.